everybody. Today we're going to take a look at the process of digestion. The ability to acquire and utilize nutrients is one of the key characteristics of living things. So if you take a look at all of the animals around me on this slide, you can see that each one is acquiring nutrients. Now, the next stop is going to be utilization of those nutrients. So the question that we'll try to answer during this talk today is, how do we go from these raw, large pieces of nutrients into a much smaller version of it by breaking it down and getting it to the end destination, which is our cells, where they will get utilized at that point? So what I did was I made a sandwich, and my sandwich is made of bread, I have cheese, and I have some meat in my sandwich. Now, those three things are going to contain all four of the major biomolecules that essentially our cells are going to need. And it's through that sandwich's breakdown that we will be able to then utilize the nutrients that make up that sandwich. So if someone asks, why do living things really need to eat? It's very simple to say, oh, because without those things, they would die. But getting more scientific, getting more biological, why do living things need these nutrients? There's a few reasons. Number one, since we've passed this cellular respiration chapter, we know that chemical energy for cellular processes is required. We are going to need organic building blocks for biosynthesis, because as we break down and we recycle older cellular components, we need to replenish them. And then lastly, essential nutrients for survival. We need trace elements and trace minerals in order to stay healthy. Without those tiny little nutrients being present, we become sick and our lifespan is shortened, and with biological living organisms possibly taking away their chance of reproduction. Okay, so let's get into this. Now, if we take a look at the overall digestive process amongst various living things, it doesn't necessarily have to be this cat, we could apply it to a lot more. What we're going to see is that we always start with ingestion. Ingestion is just the taking in of food into the body in some way. And in the case of the cat here, it's going to start with mechanical digestion. Now, mechanical digestion is when we go from large pieces of food to small pieces of food, which you can see here. So the cat chews up its kibble and breaks those big pieces into little pieces. So mechanical digestion occurs upon ingesting the food. Second, digestion begins. Now, I can't go too far from the mouth for digestion, because digestion actually starts to occur in the mouth as well by way of chemical digestion. How does that work? Well, not only are the teeth crunching up those pieces of food and making them smaller, but we also have parts of the saliva, chemical parts of the saliva, which are called enzymes, which are going to go to work on breaking up some of those larger food particles as well. Third, we have absorption. Absorption is where the now small particles of food have to leave the digestive tract and somehow integrate into cells. Now, they may take a couple of different ways to get there. They have to take a ride in the bloodstream, but eventually their final destination is going to be inside of cells, and that's where absorption occurs. Small molecules, nutrient molecules, they need to enter into those body cells. Now, of course, when these processes are finished, sometimes we're left with some matter that didn't get either absorbed or it didn't get utilized in some way. And of course, that's what we call waste. And waste gets eliminated in living things. We're going to take a look at very simple animals, and we're going to go from simple to complex, just so you can kind of get a wider view of the various types of digestive systems that occur in animals. And the first one that we're going to look at is by way of a flatworm called a planarian. And a planarian has what we call an incomplete digestive tract. Now, the reason it's incomplete is because it only has one opening. It has a mouth, which also serves as an anus. So with that single opening, you now have what we call an incomplete digestive tract. Now, how does food get into our planarian? Well, the pharynx here, this little semi-muscular little organ, is going to draw food in, And that food is then going to be able to spread throughout the thin body of this planarian. You'll notice that there is a bunch of hollow areas, and this particular little critter is comprised of a large central, what's called a gastrovascular cavity, which you can see here. So there is a big hollow spot in the middle where fluid is. Inside of that fluid, we also have digestive enzymes, but this creature is so thin, it's only a few layers thick, that it's able to not only take in and break down molecules in this cavity, but it can also just let those particles diffuse into the cells that line that gastrovascular tract. When the food comes in, either the lysosome is going to merge with the food vacuole, break it down, and the waste particles, whatever's not needed by the cell, is going to leave again, and it will eventually come back out the mouth and through the pharynx. Any nutrients that we need are going to be utilized by the cells around that particular food vacuole breakdown. So the key traits amongst simple animals that have incomplete digestive tracts are that food enters through the mouth and muscular pharynx, waste exits through the mouth and muscular pharynx, and it lacks any specialized parts. If we take a look at more complex animals, you're going to find that there are two openings. Of course, there's a mouth, and then, of course, there's a separate anus. This digestive tube is called a complete digestive tract. So the criteria for being complete is that there are two openings. Some will call it an alimentary canal. Within complete digestive tracts, you're going to find more specialized organs along the way. It's a lot more complex than what we just saw with the planarian. So even if we take a look at something we consider simple, such as the earthworm, you can see that it has various compartments. It does have a pharynx and a mouth, just like the planarian, but it also has an esophagus, a crop, a gizzard, a very long intestine, and then finally it ends with an anus. So these specialized parts, every one does a certain thing. For example, the esophagus passes food from the pharynx to this holding area called a crop. The gizzard is an area where there's sand and small rocks, which is going to crush up the organic debris that this particular worm ingests. The debris then is going to travel down through the intestine, and in every segment in this earthworm, it's going to be extracting nutrients until what reaches the end of the earthworm is a very nutrient poor waste. It will also extract and utilize any fluid along the way, and it will release as a final product a nitrogenous waste that tends to be stripped of everything it started with. If we take a look at something like a grasshopper, you can see again we have multiple specialized parts along the way, and most importantly, for a complete digestive tract, you have the opening, both the mouth and the anus opening. Birds, we see some of the same type parts. We see an esophagus, which connects food from the mouth to the crop. We have a stomach, we have a gizzard, and eventually the food will reach the anus as well. And again, that is a complete digestive tract. Taking a look at some more complex animals, we can take a look at a clam and compare it to a squid. And there are some key differences here that go with the mode of feeding that these animals do. For example, a clam participates in what's called continuous filter feeding or continuous feeding. And what that means is it never really stops feeding. How a clam feeds is that it has an in-current siphon that draws fluid inside of the clam. The organic matter and the small living things will get caught on these gills right here and then get passed up the gill surface to this area right here. We have a couple of labial palps which are going to help push the food into the mouth, and once inside the mouth it's going to enter the stomach where digestive glands will secrete their enzymes to break down that matter. It's a continuous motion. After the food has been properly broken down, it's going to travel through this kind of pretzel-looking tube right here, which is kind of a primitive type of intestine, and it will release food out of its anus. So it is a complete digestive system. It is a continuous filter feeder. Now, the stomach, in comparison to the creature here, is pretty small, and it's continuously working. So you don't need an entire food storage area like a crop or a gizzard in a clam. You just need a small stomach in order to digest those little things that come through. Now, the squid, on the other hand, this one is not going to continuously feed. This one has to capture prey, which may or may not be abundant. And if they're not, it's going to need to take on bigger meals. And it does so as a discontinuous feeder. So when it does find prey to eat, it's going to jam its stomach full of food. And by having this holding area of a stomach and being able to expand, it's going to be able to slowly digest that material and not need to continuously ingest calories. It will take in bigger meals than the clam will, and it will take time to digest that. So it has a special food storage area needed. Its stomach is going to work in that capacity. Now, before I get to this slide here, let me go back here just for 1 second. Each one of these has some specialized abilities, some specialized adaptations in order to ingest and then utilize the nutrients that it takes in. So the clam, you can see it has a gill set. It's a continuous feeder, uses a siphon to bring food in, where a squid is going to have to do more hunting, and it's going to use these tentacled arms in order to capture its prey. So these are specialized adaptations that are related to diet. Okay. Now, if we take a look at some other ones, one of the things that we could look at amongst different mammalian species is the fact that dentition will differ as an adaptation to the diet. So the assortment of teeth that a particular animal have will tend to match what it tends to ingest. So if we take a look at, for example, a carnivore, we can see that it has some fairly large canines, and these canine teeth are used for tearing and shredding, shearing pieces off of flesh after it captures its prey. Secondly, an herbivore. If we take a look at its skull, we're going to see teeth that aren't as severe looking as these. They're going to have relatively flat bottoms. You might have some chisel-shaped teeth along the way. And these are more suited for clipping. So it's going to clip leaves and grasses and things like that and then grind them down in this wide surface here before they swallow it. And then, of course, there's omnivores. We're one of those, where we kind of have a hybrid version between that kind of teeth and that kind of teeth. And we have varied diets, so we eat a little bit of everything. Some people are strictly, you know, vegetarians. Other people are heavy carnivores. And then we have all kinds of people who are in between. So that's why we're called an omnivore. We eat both vegetation and we eat meat. So if we break down the digestive systems, the one we're going to take a look at most closely is the mammalian digestive system, and we'll kind of use a human as the main focus of the rest of the talk today. Humans have a complete digestive system, that is, we have a mouth and we have an anus, and often it's called the alimentary canal. And by way of this schematic here, you can see that it's a long tube that has a start, and way down here it has a finish. And there's some various compartments along the way, and we even have some accessory glands that are going to help out along the way. Here's one, and here's three in close proximity. Those accessory glands that go along with the main tube from mouth to anus are these. We have salivary glands, we have a liver, we have a pancreas, and we have a gallbladder. Let's go ahead and take a look. We're going to start from the mouth and we're going to work our way down the digestive system till the end. Okay, for those of you who aren't aware of what these things actually look like, here you go. We have three pairs of salivary glands up here. Couple of them are situated underneath into your jaw area. One's under the tongue, one's under your jawbone, and one is towards the side of your face. We also have a liver, which is the largest organ in the body, and you can see how big it is. It completely takes up the upper right quadrant of your abdomen, and it even spills over into the left side. We have this little gallbladder right here, which is a storage area for some products that are made around here. We also have a pancreas. Pancreas is going to help a whole bunch of different ways of the body, in a homeostatic kind of way and in a digestive kind of way. And we'll give more details when we get to the pancreas. Okay, so here's our official starting point, the mouth, of course. And your teeth are organs of mastication. What is mastication? It's chewing. So what is the function of your teeth? You're cutting, you're tearing, and you're grinding food. And why do you do that? Well, because it's easier for the rest of the system to utilize food if it has been broken down and the surface area has been increased. If you increase the surface area, you are now greatly enhancing the chance that an enzyme will be able to hit a particular spot on that little piece of food and break it down further. For those that don't know, for a total, we have 32 teeth. We have 16 on top, 16 on the bottom. Okay, so once in the mouth, the salivary glands then are going to secrete their contents, their moisture and their enzymes, and that is going to go ahead and start to work on the breakdown of the nutrients that you've ingested. Now, those salivary glands are pretty active. They secrete about a liter of saliva each day. Now, I said they are going to work on a particular type of nutrient. That nutrient are carbohydrates. So saliva is going to go ahead and help that go faster by secreting an enzyme called amylase, and that amylase is going to work in carbohydrate breakdown. So if we take a look at our picture here, we can see that we have a polysaccharide right here, a many unit sugar, which we know collectively as a carb, and that carb is then going upon entry into the mouth to be hit with the saliva from our salivary glands. And what that will do is it will enhance hydrolysis, which is the use of enzymes to break down big things into little things. So polysaccharides are broken into disaccharides by amylase. So disaccharides mean it's a two-unit sugar at this point, which is much smaller than what we saw initially. Okay, so where does it go from there? Well, it's going to keep continuing down our digestive tract, and eventually it's going to wind up in the stomach. Now, we're still pretty high up in the body of the digestive system right now, but if we were to take kind of just a sneak peek ahead at what's going to happen, we're going to see that deactivation occurs in acidic stomach lumen. Now, what's being deactivated? Well, what's being deactivated is the enzymes amylase, because amylase has a particular environment that is at its optimum, and that is not going to be a pH of 1 or 2 that's found in the stomach. So the stomach acid is going to render the salivary amylase inactive because the stomach has its own job to do, which we'll see later. Okay, what we'll do is we'll go ahead and we'll keep moving down the digestive system. Next stop, swallowing. So the act of swallowing is going to take place not only in the mouth, but the throat, and then onto our esophagus. Some of the main actions that go on there is that a food bolus is swallowed. A food bolus is nothing more than chewed up food that's now mixed with saliva and amylase. And in our picture here, you can see it as this green colored food right there. I don't know, maybe it's jello or something. Okay, so what happens during this swallowing process? Three stages. First, the oral stage is voluntary. You control when you want to swallow. The bolus will sit on the depression in the center of your tongue, and the bolus will then press against your palate and move back into what's called the oropharynx, the rear of your mouth. So when your tongue presses upward here, it pushes the food towards the back. Now, as it pushes the food towards the back, I want you to notice something. Here you have an opening, and that is to your nasal cavity. But what is protecting that nasal cavity is what we call our soft palate. And you see that it kind of works like a trap door and that it's shutting against the back of the oropharynx, and that's closing it off so food doesn't wind up in your nasal cavity. So it's like the first trap door that slams shut. That's stage one. It's oral, it's voluntary. Second, is our pharyngeal stage. Now, this is involuntary. Once food has gone past the first, the oral stage, it's a kind of all systems go at this point. Three openings typically close off during the second stage, the pharyngeal stage of swallowing. We already saw that the trapdoor of our soft palate closes shut, which we have right here. We also see the mouth typically closed. And then lastly, we have this little thing right here. Okay. Now, a couple of things. Number one, what we have past that in this whitish looking tube, this is our airway. And what we don't want is this food going from right here into our airway. That would be bad. So instead, what we have happen is that the epiglottis, which is this tiny little structure right here, is going to fold downward and it's going to close off your respiratory tract to food. So we have our mouth closed, we have our soft palate closed, and we have our epiglottis closed, and now our green bolus of food is able to slide down the right tube, which is your esophagus. For the last stage of swallowing, it's the esophageal stage. Again, all systems are go at this point. This is controlled by the medulla, part of your brainstem. And once it has passed that oropharynx and it's on its way down, it is now headed towards its next destination. The process of swallowing is a pretty fast process. However, you typically stop breathing for 1 to 3 seconds while you actually swallow, because again, we don't want food going into the wrong set of tubes. So the tube that carries the food down to its next location is called the esophagus. It's collapsible, it's muscular, and it's lined with mucus. It's about 25 centimeters or 10 inches long. And one of the key things that it does do is it travels through your diaphragm. Your diaphragm is a muscular sheet, which you can see right here, and that sheet aids in breathing. So it's going to have a central hole for the esophagus to travel through. It lies posterior to the trachea. So what that means is that the esophagus is in back of your windpipe, and it's also posterior to the heart. So it's behind your heart as well. The heart is kind of in that particular area, so it's behind that. And its job, of course, is to connect that oropharynx to, of course, your stomach. Stomach is the next major organ down the line. During rest, the tube is mostly flat, so the lumen is non-existent in this state. What does that mean? Well, if you think of a garden hose, especially the ones that you purchased a while back, they're just kind of round and they constantly have a hole down the center, whether there's water in it or not. Now, lately I've been seeing these hoses on commercials that go flat, except when you put water in them. That's kind of how your esophagus works. It's flat until there's something going through it. Then it rounds out upon food passing through. Now, of course, we can swallow while laying on our backs, and that food will still wind up getting down to our stomach. And it does so because of this word here, peristalsis. Peristalsis is a wave-like ripple of muscles through a hollow organ. It's involuntary, and of course, it's moving food downward. And if we take a look at how it actually works and why it works, part of it is in the anatomy of the tube itself, of the esophagus and the layers that make it up. One of the things that occurs is that there are stretch receptors in this outer layer of the esophagus. Now, as you can see, as food pushes through that layer, what happens is this tissue gets stretched. And that tissue getting stretched is going to stimulate circular muscle, which surrounds the esophagus, to contract down like you see here. So as soon as food passes through it, the immediate reaction is that the muscles will close it down and in doing so push the food forward. So there's circular muscles surrounding your esophagus, which when they're stretched, they react by contracting down, squeezing the food forward. The bolus will keep going towards its eventual destination, which is going to be the stomach. So now we're there. We've made it. Position and size. It's shaped like a J, as you can see, and it's found in your LUQ. Your LUQ is your left upper quadrant. So if you look down at yourself right now and you split yourself into four pieces, your left side on top is where you're going to find your stomach. Here's a nice example of that. So what we have is we have our stomach in this portion right there. And that stomach, kind of like the esophagus, it can collapse a bit when it's empty. But when it's full, it can hold up to 2 liters, sometimes even more, of contents. If you were to eat that much, sometimes it can be a scary at times because you don't feel so great. And some people have thought they might be having a heart attack because they ate so much. It pushed against that diaphragm, inhibiting their ability to breathe properly. And it also pressed on their heart too, giving them chest pain. So you can fill that J-shaped bag with a lot of food. And you typically know you've eaten too much if what you find is a shortness of breath and you think you're having a heart attack. So try not to eat meals that are that big in size. Of course, some animals, they completely go against that. They've adapted to eat very large meals. As you know, some of the animals of the African savanna will eat and eat and eat until they can't put another morsel in their body and they sleep for a long time after. But their bodies are designed for that. They've adapted in that way. The stomach has 2 sphincter muscles. Sphincter muscles are muscles that are shaped in a ring. So where we find them is one is going to be here, and we have one here. The first one is called the LES, the lower esophageal sphincter. Why? Because at the bottom of your esophagus. So it's called the lower esophageal sphincter. And it controls the opening. After food has gone down your esophagus and made it into the stomach, you want that to close off, because you don't want half-digested acidic food going back up into your esophagus. So a lot of people will have heartburn because possibly their sphincter has an abnormality or a weakness, and it allows that acidic content to go back up into the esophagus, and the acid then burns the bottom of the esophagus through the tissue. Of course, at the other end, we have the pyloric sphincter, which is a circular closing of the stomach to the small intestine. The area of the small intestine that it goes into is called the duodenum. And aside from these 2 sphincters that trap the food on the inside, let's take a closer look at the stomach itself. There are folds all over the stomach, and you see them here. These folds extend out. They're called rugae, and they allow, for instance, for you to eat 2 liters of food and not rupture your stomach. So it's like kind of like a bed sheet that has a lot of folds, and it can stretch out to quite a bit larger than it looks. The epithelial tissue, which is the tissue on the surface of the stomach here, it contains gastric pits, which secrete digestive juices from secreting cells, and of course, hydrochloric acid as well. Pepsin is a digestive enzyme that's produced in the stomach. Its target, of course, is going to be protein. So your stomach is a big protein digestive bag. Pepsin should facilitate the hydrolysis of polypeptides. So once again, first we saw it in the mouth with amylase, where hydrolysis was working on the long-chain carbohydrates. And now we also have hydrolysis working on polypeptides, breaking those peptide bonds in between amino acids. Hydrochloric acid is going to activate the enzyme pepsin. Let's take a look at the chemistry real quick and where it comes from within the stomach tissues. So down here, notice that we have 2 types of cells. We have pink cells and we have yellow cells. The pink cells are called chief cells. And the chief cells secrete an enzyme, pre-enzyme called pepsinogen. Now, for pepsinogen to be turned into active pepsin, it's going to require hydrochloric acid. And the cells that make the hydrochloric acid are called parietal cells. They secrete H+ ions, and they secrete Cl ions, which find each other. That forms hydrochloric acid, and that is the chemical trigger that changes pepsinogen to pepsin, and now you can break up your proteins into the amino acids. The stomach, not only does it chemically digest, but there is a little mechanical breakdown happening here, a little mechanical digestion. Food in the stomach has gone from being what was a bolus to now what we call chyme. Chyme is kind of the mixture of both the swallowed food and now pepsin and hydrochloric acid. Food is churned via muscles of the stomach wells, the stomach walls. We have four different layers of muscles on the outside, which can squish that stomach every which way in order to help properly break down the food into something more manageable. So as peristalsic contractions get stronger, chyme will eventually squirt through the pyloric sphincter and into the duodenum of the small intestine. So what we're looking at is when the food is ready, it's going to go through this opening here and reach the small intestine. Now, this duodenal area is very small, so it can't all dump in there at one time. Instead, little by little, the food will empty from the stomach and enter the duodenum. When there is a huge amount of food that is trying to make it down, the duodenum will actually secrete some hormones which will slow down these peristalsic contractions. So these will secrete hormones into the blood, and then what happens here is it kind of has a negative feedback type of mechanism on the peristalsis that's happening with the stomach muscles, slow everything down because it's trying to push too much through into the small intestine at once. And when there's too much food in the small intestine, it doesn't get digested properly. When that occurs, we call that the gastrointestinal reflex. Gastro for stomach, intestinal for the small intestine. Which happens to be our next spot. So our small intestine, you can see it right starting here at 4. And after number 4, it's going to head down this way through this long tube all the way until it reaches this point right here. Okay, so the three divisions. First, we've mentioned the duodenum. That's stop number 1. Begins at the pyloric sphincter. You have about 10 inches or 25 centimeters until you reach the next stop. The next stop, portion 2, is called the jejunum. The jejunum is pretty long, 2.5 meters and 8 feet long. So it kind of wraps around the interior of the abdomen here. And then we hit the last portion, which is called the ileum. Sorry about that. Ileum is the longest portion at 12 feet long, and it's going to wind up connecting with the large intestine. Of course, this is a little bit out of scale with the numbers here, but if we went 12 feet, we'd probably have to say more like here is where it starts. Okay, so we have various parts of the small intestines divided into three different ones. Get used to saying the words duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. So what is the environment of the small intestine like? Well, first of all, you have left a very low pH organ with the stomach. You were pH of 1 or 2 in the stomach, and you immediately change into a new environment, which is basic. And a basic environment means that the pH is over 7. And in fact, this pH of the small intestine is about 8. So one thing that's going to happen is any enzymes that are in the chyme that is now traveling to the duodenum is now going to be rendered inactive because, again, optimum environment for things, including enzymes, if they're not in it, they denature and they don't work right anymore. Another thing that's going to happen is that the stomach acid will be neutralized going from a 2 to an 8. As far as its position and overall size, you just saw its position on the last diagram, 6 meters long, so we're talking about 20 feet here, and of course it's the longest portion of the gastrointestinal tract. Not only is there a lot of chemical things that are going to happen here, but there's also a motility involved, which we will still see peristalsis because of circular muscles around the outside of the small intestine. We're also going to see segmentation, which is an additional breaking down, an additional mechanical digestion of that food that's traveling through it. So in the duodenum, segmentation is important for the mixing of chyme with digestive juices. From the liver and the intestines and the pancreas, they're all going to play a part. They're all going to contribute into the center of this tube during the small intestinal trip. Food will take about 5 to 6 hours to make it through. Here is an idea of what segmentation is like. You can see when the circular muscles are able to push down, whatever's traveling through here has a great chance of being broken up and mixed more thoroughly. So if there's multiple circular muscles closing at the same time, not only will it move it forward, but it's also going to break it up and mix it together. And again, the peristalsic wave is when we have the round muscles and they keep contracting as stuff goes through it, pushing it forward, forward progress of your food. So not only is there movement, but of course there's going to be additions to just the food that's coming down because we need help in order to break those things down further. And the accessory organs, which you mentioned back in the beginning, they are going to play a key part. Your liver, your gallbladder, your pancreas, they're going to squirt their contributions into the small intestine, particularly the duodenal portion through a small hole. And the major contributors here are going to be bile, trypsin, and pancreatic juice, which has a number of things inside of it. Part of that juice is going to be bicarbonate, which is needed to neutralize the acidic content of the chyme. So we talked about how there was a change in pH from 2 to 8. That bicarbonate is going to be a key reason for that as well. Here are those accessory organs and how they contribute into the small intestine. So the liver is actually really large and it's up here. And we have a couple of bile ducts here, a left one and a right one. And they are going to collect bile and send it down through the common hepatic duct where some of it will be stored in the gallbladder here and some of it will be released down here and will actually combine with the secretions from the pancreas, and they're both going to wind up coming out of the same hole called the sphincter of Oddi, and it's going to combine with the chyme that is passing through. Now, the intestinal walls themselves have folds as well. They're called villi, and what you see here, this is an example of one of those folds, okay? So this is just a single one. We would call this a villus as a singular. Each one of these villi has an arteriole, a venule, and a lacteal. Now, our next talk, we're going to hit blood vessels and anatomy of blood vessels, but what we can definitely look at these colors here, and we can code them to what we find in this picture. So the red would be the arteriole, the blue is the venule, and the green is the lacteal. All three of these are tubes that fluid passes through. Because we eat different types of food, of course, we have protein, we have carbohydrates, and we have fats. And all three of these are going to need to make their way into one of these villi. And that is how eventually we're going to be able to transfer those nutrients into the cells, like we said earlier. So the amino acids, which we're now getting from the stomach after pepsin and hydrochloric acid have worked on them, and sugars are both going to enter the blood capillaries of the villus. So that means that they are going to have to come in through here and get inside of those tubes. Now, fats, on the other hand, we know they're made of glycerol and fatty acids. And what they're going to have to do is they're going to have to go through some special conformational changes. And eventually, they have to get in this green area here, which is called the lacteal. Now, one of the things that allows a villus to be to work with great efficiency and have enormous absorptive area is the fact that each villus has little tiny, what we call microvilli, all over them. So if we take a look at the border right here, you can see there's like hairs all over the border of these cells on the outside. And that's going to help increase surface area for absorption. We call that the brush border because when you look at it on our microscope, it kind of looks like a little tiny brush. The purpose of the villi and the microvilli is to increase then the surface area for absorption. So a lot of digestion occurs within the small intestine. Let's look at carbohydrates first. On those villi of the small intestine epithelial cells sit enzymes, sucrase, lactase, and maltase. These enzymes break down disaccharides into glucose on the spot, and we call that contact digestion. So what that means is that we have various enzymes, and they are going to sit, if we look down here, right on the surface of all of these villi, and they're just awaiting disaccharides to land on them so then they can split them, hydrolyze them into single sugars. So if we take a look at this picture here, we have glucose polymers, which are broken down by amylase, and they're digested into disaccharides like maltose, sucrose, and lactose. And what that means is that if you have healthy maltase, sucrase, and lactase enzymes, you're going to be able to split maltase into two glucose monomers. You're going to be able to split sucrose into a glucose and a fructose. And then lactase is going to split lactose in half into one glucose and one galactose, all of which are monosaccharides, all of which will be absorbed into the villus and then into the bloodstream. The breakdown of the carbohydrates gets help from both salivary amylase and pancreatic amylase, one of the secretions that the pancreas does to the chyme as it passes through. So carbohydrates will get worked on once again inside the small intestine. They took a break in the stomach, and initially were starting to be digested in the mouth. So the next look we'll take next thing we'll take a look at is protein being digested. And we know that proteins are made of amino acids at their most basic level. So they're going to be broken down by pepsin from the gastric juice, trypsin from the pancreatic juice, and then peptidases from intestinal cells. So there's not going to be a whole lot of absorption for these big molecules, these macromolecules, to get in the cells unless they're down to the single or just a couple of amino acid levels. So as you can see in this picture here, amino acids can come in to an intestinal cell, usually transported or facilitated through the membrane by way of a protein. Some small peptides, there are some transporters that can, bring in a dipeptide or a tripeptide, which will eventually be broken into a singular amino acid, and then they will also find their way into the bloodstream. The third biomolecule, which is fats, they're going to need some additional chemical manipulation in order to enter into, to get in technically into the body. It's not until you do certain chemical aspects to a fat that they'll be allowed into a cell. The word that we're looking for here is emulsification. Fats must be emulsified to begin this journey into an enterocyte, an intestinal cell. So they have to be converted to small droplets as a first step in order to be digested. So I want you to take a look at this large picture first. This picture here shows oil sitting on top of water. If you're to mix oil with something called lecithin, what's going to happen is the oil will break up from being this huge layer of long fatty acid chains into spherical molecules called micelles. Micelles are going to be more utilizable, more digestible than a big sample of fat and oil coming down through an intestine. There's certain enzymes that can only hit that fat and begin to digest it when it's in that form, and they have the name of lipases because they work on lipids. They take them apart. But if you take a look at what a micelle looks like in terms of its anatomy, you can see that we still see those phospholipids that we saw the membranes made of, but now there's not a double layer. Now there's just a single layer, and you can see that in the center, you'll find oil compatible with the hydrophobic core. So these legs, we know that they're hydrophobic, and if like dissolves like, then this oil that's trapped in the center has no problem with being there. And meanwhile, the H2O on the outside really likes the hydrophilic heads of the phosphate group that sits on top of these. So, additionally, what's going to add some contributions to fat digestion is bile. We mentioned that bile is made in the liver, stored in the gallbladder, and it's released in the small intestine via the common bile duct. Lecithin and bile salts and pancreatic lipase will then emulsify those fats that are going down the small intestine, turn them into the micelles, and then they're going to be allowed access to the intestinal cells when they're in that form. So here we can see in the picture that we have the contribution of bile salts, from the liver and the gallbladder. We can see that pancreatic lipase is going to add itself as well into the duodenal area of the small intestine as chyme is passing through, as that food is making its way through. Now, as far as the fat absorption, the lipases will break down those micelles right outside the cells into free fatty acids and monoglycerides that you can see here. So if this is a triglyceride, you'll notice that here is just the fatty acid tails, and here's the glycerol with a fatty acid called a monoglyceride. Those are going to have no problem getting in through the cell membrane, because that's made of phospholipid, nonpolar in the same manner. Once inside the cells will actually reassemble those into those spare parts into a triglyceride. And with a little bit more of some chemical rearranging and mangling, we're going to then wind up changing that triglyceride into what's called a chylomicron micelle. And what this is going to do is this is going to be allowed out of the intestinal cell and into the lymph channel called a lacteal that we saw when we looked at an individual villus a few slides ago. Once this makes it through the lymph system, it can then be dumped into the veins, the blood in the veins. This is a big picture of the small intestine, and as food is coming down, we know that, you know, on the surface of all of these intestinal cells, we have villi, and the villi increase the absorptive capabilities of these cells. There's enzymes that sit on the top, it's called the brush border. There's microvilli that sits on every villus. All of that in order to send those nutrients through the veins, which eventually are going to link up with what's called a hepatic portal vein. So after you take in nutrients, it's going to be sent to a new location via this portal vein. And before it makes it to the overall bloodstream, it has to make one pit stop. But basically, this is the pathway for these ingested nutrients to eventually make it into cells. If we summarize what we've seen so far with the three major biomolecules, carbs, proteins, and fats, what we can see are the three different strategies for getting in a cell. So with a carbohydrate, it's hit by not only salivary amylase, but pancreatic amylase. That is going to allow the transition to disaccharides instead of polysaccharides. The brush border enzymes like maltase will be able to split disaccharides into monosaccharides, which will then be allowed into the cell and into the bloodstream. With amino acids, with proteins, we know that trypsin is one of the enzymes that's going to break it from a polypeptide into a smaller peptide. Peptidases are going to break down smaller peptides into single amino acids, and these are also going to be allowed into the cell via protein carrier and into the bloodstream. And then we just got through with the fats, where bile salts are going to emulsify fat globules, turn them into micelles, which are then going to be broken into free fatty acids and monoglycerides. These are going to enter the cell, be reformed into eventually what's called a chylomicron, make it into a lacteal, be part of the lymph system for a little while before dumping into the main bloodstream. While we're here, I wanted to just throw in an example of homeostasis, since it's a recurring theme in biology, into our talk about that digestive system. And what I want to take a look at is this flow chart that we see here. Because we know as food content in chyme comes out of the stomach, there's an increase in acid in the duodenum. Okay, all that acidic content from the stomach is not just instantly shut down. It reaches the duodenum, and the duodenum can actually detect that. So there's a signal detection. Now, the duodenum also works as it's going to secrete its own hormones into the blood. And one of the hormones that it secretes is called secretin. Secretin will make it into the blood vessels, circulate around. The signal will be detected from the pancreas, And then the pancreas is going to secrete its own bicarbonate solution in response. And we said earlier that the bicarbonate is going to work to neutralize the acidic content of what's coming down the small intestine. The overall final response is a decrease in acid in the duodenum by way of all these steps. So we can think of that as a big negative feedback loop in homeostasis. Again, another summary slide here with some key enzymes that work on specific biomolecules. Fats, we know, are worked on by the enzyme lipase. Proteins, one of them that works on them, besides pepsin, is proteases. It's kind of a general term for enzymes that break down proteins and their amino acids. And then starch is worked on by amylase, and it's broken into simple sugars. I wanted to pit stop at some of the accessory organs because their jobs are so important as aids to the digestive system. The first stop, we'll take a look at the pancreas. The pancreas is grayish pink in color, 12 to 15 centimeters long, weighs about 60 grams, and it runs from the duodenum to behind the stomach, and it will actually reach the spleen. So what we'll see is that as this wraps around, this tip here kind of touches the spleen, and that's kind of when you're looking inside of the anatomy and you're trying to figure out what organ is what, especially when we do our dissections, this spleen here is, the spleen will touch the end of the pancreas. And if you wanted to break the pancreas into parts, we have the big head over here on the touching the duodenum. We have the neck, the body, and the tail. And you can see that it's also situated under this big red organ, which is the liver. Here's the gallbladder. And we said earlier they have a common port that they dump their contents into to reach the small intestine. Okay, so the pancreas and all of its importance has not only its digestive functions, but it also has endocrine functions as well. The pancreatic tissue has various parts called pancreatic islets. And these islets, which you can see here, and they're blown up into a much bigger view right here, they're made of alpha cells and beta cells. And those regulate blood sugar. So it's related to digestion, but they have a little bit different mode of how they work. These are ductless glands. They don't squirt their contents into a duct to wind up, you know, going down this tube here into the small intestine. Instead, they secrete it into the bloodstream, which you can see here by these arrows. And you can see that they're now entering the splenic artery blood vessel in order to change what they actually work on, which has to do with blood sugar. So let's talk about the endocrine action of the pancreas, okay? Endocrine means ductless. We just mentioned that they secrete their hormones into the bloodstream, and they do so when the blood sugar rises in the bloodstream. So after you've eaten a rich meal and your blood sugar goes up, your pancreas will actually secrete insulin, which binds to cells and allows sugar to enter the cells, thus lowering the blood sugar level. So what we can say is this: as blood sugar goes up, what happens is the pancreas will respond to that by secreting from its beta cells insulin into the bloodstream. The bloodstream is then going to take the insulin to all the cells, and the cells will then go ahead and allow sugar to enter the cells, which takes the sugar out of the bloodstream. So increased sugar from meal will lead to a decrease in sugar from insulin action. Now, there is kind of a flip side to this too, because the pancreatic islets of the pancreas also have alpha cells. Alpha cells are going to secrete a different hormone called glucagon, which comes into play when blood sugar is very low. So if you haven't eaten in a while and your blood sugar starts dipping, one of the things glucagon can do when it's secreted in the bloodstream is it can allow for the release of glucose from the glycogen in the liver, thus raising the blood sugar level. So they're both homeostatic functions. They work to regulate blood sugar. and they're from an endocrine portion of the pancreas. Now, let's hit the digestive functions of the pancreas. The exocrine function of the pancreas has acinar cells and duct cells, which secrete digestive enzymes and sodium bicarbonate. The presence of ducts allows you to distinguish them from endocrine function. So these cells here are going to secrete their contents into these ducts, which eventually make it into the small intestine. The liver. The liver is the largest gland in your body. It sits underneath your diaphragm in your right upper quadrant, and it even is so big that it crosses the midline over into the left upper quadrant. Its function is a gatekeeper, because anything that you wind up eating is going to wind up eventually being filtered through this gigantic organ. It's going to remove, detoxify poisons. It's going to store vitamins, and it's going to be a key player in blood glucose as well. So here's how it looks inside of the abdomen, and here's how it looks when an artist gives you a nice picture of one. Now, what you can see here is the fact there's a lot of blood vessels. You have some on the underside, you have some on the top side. And then the liver tissue itself is kind of like in between the two. Now, what's going to happen is food that you ate that winds up in the bloodstream is going to wind up coming through these tubes here, which is called the portal vein, because it's going to be cleaned up a bit from whatever meal you just ate. So the nutrients that you ate are going to wind up in the hepatic portal vein, and they're going to wind up being worked on by the liver before they're released into this hepatic vein here to become part of your bloodstream. So we said that they are kind of a gatekeeper, which means the liver has a filtering capability. So if you look at our very simplistic picture here, you have bad stuff coming in and you got good filtrate coming out. Okay, so where this happens is, of course, within the liver, we have what's called lobules on the inside where we have phagocytic cells waiting. They're waiting for stuff to come through like pathogens, worn out material, anything that needs to be removed from the bloodstream. And that happens in this area here. This is just a corner of a lobule that they've kind of opened up and gave you a view to the inside of the liver. Now, to see a bigger view of that, we could take a look at this. Here we have the blood from our gut, from our colon, and it's going to be entering right here where it's going to join up with some oxygenated blood from the hepatic artery this way. Here we have some cells that are waiting. These are called Kupffer cells, and these are part of the cells that clean up the blood. And once it makes it through this maze here, some of the fluid that passes through is going to wind up as the beginnings of what we know as bile, and they're going to make it into this duct here as the liver cells form little channels. And that bile is going to kind of go in the opposite direction as the rest of the fluid. The rest of the fluid is going to wind up, once it's cleaned up, going to the blood supply, whereas the bile is going to head the other way, and it's going to wind up going down the bile duct and being stored in the gallbladder. The hepatic cells form those ducts. Hepatic means liver, and we just saw one of these ducts that's right here. And there are little tiny canaliculi, which are connecting ducts that are actually going to wind up doing those draining aspects of the blood filtering. Okay, so here is again our big picture view of our liver, and we know that now it contains bile salts, which emulsify fat, and it also contains something called bilirubin, which is going to cause it to be a greenish yellow color. The right and left hepatic duct sit on the underside of the liver. Here would be the left and here would be the right, and they are going to allow that bile to flow downward through that bile system. Another aspect of the liver, though, is it's also a warehouse for blood sugar storage. So when blood sugar levels are high, insulin release, which we just talked about with the pancreas, allows liver cells to store glucose in the form of glycogen. So we call that gliconeogenesis. It has a real nice big word, but it basically means that new glycogen is stored there. When the levels are low, however, glycogen can be broken down, and it's going to release that sugar back in the bloodstream, which is called glycogenolysis, and that helps maintain a steady blood sugar level. Okay, we're almost there. We've made it to the large intestine. As far as size and location, it's in your abdomen. It kind of surrounds your small intestine. So you kind of see here it has this, where your small intestine would be on the inside. It kind of just wraps around it. The diameter itself is much larger than that of the small intestine. It's about 5 to 6 feet long, and it can have, a diameter of up to 4 to 5 inches. As far as structure, it has mucus glands along the way. It coats the feces as they pass through, which is undigested material. It has longitudinal muscles and tape-like strips. So what that means is that these muscles go this way on the intestine, and they are going to help move things forward in the large intestine as well. There's also ring muscles, which are on the outside here, which again, we talk segmentation, we talk peristalsis as well. A function of the large intestine is that it houses what we all know as E. coli or Escherichia coli. It breaks down indigestible materials that we can't handle, and it produces vitamin K as well. Other jobs of the large intestine: absorption of ions like sodium, potassium, acids, bases, and water. And of course, it's a waste transporter. The large intestine also has three divisions. The first division is called the cecum, which is the earliest part of the large intestine. You see it here. The small intestine is going to dump into the cecum. At the bottom of the cecum, you're going to find what we call the appendix. The appendix is believed to be kind of a storehouse of bacteria. In case something happens to our normal gut flora, you can replenish it with what's found in the appendix. And that's believed to be a prehistoric adaptation. The second segment of the large intestine is called the colon, and the colon is subdivided into four parts. The first part is the ascending colon. So what sounds kind of strange is that waste actually travels upward, and if you look up here in the corner, it actually goes in an upward direction. Secondly, we have a transverse portion. Transverse goes across, and then last, or second to last, we have the descending portion, and finally, it hits a sigmoid colon, which is kind of like an S-shaped colon. And that is the four locations that the waste must travel to eventually make it out of the organism's body. The last segment of the large intestine, whoops, I'm sorry, the last segment is called the rectum. So the rectum is 17 to 20 centimeters long, about 7 to 8 inches. The terminal inch of it is called the anal canal, and that is, of course, is where waste is released. There are two sphincters that are in control in that anal canal, and both of them have to be relaxed for waste to eventually pass through. So overall, here is our big schematic of the whole process of how food enters and how it winds up getting to all the cells of the body. And for a quick review, we know that it gets ingested through the mouth. It travels through the esophagus by way of peristalsis into the stomach. The stomach is where we see the protein being worked on by pepsin and hydrochloric acid. It makes its way into the small intestine, where at this junction, we have a whole bunch of contributions from our accessory organs. We have lipids leave the small intestine and go into the lymph system. We have carbs and we have proteins wind up going into the blood, and they will wind up headed to the hepatic portal vein in order to be cleaned up by the liver. The liver then sends the blood back to the circulatory system. Whatever doesn't make it down winds up in the large intestine, where there's a lot of water reabsorption, and whatever can't make it as waste winds up being leaving the body as elimination. So I hope this big long talk has shed more light on how the digestive system works. I hope that you understand that we go from big pieces to little pieces, and all those little pieces have to eventually make it to all the cells of the body in order for us to stay healthy. Now, of course, is this everything? No. We could do, an hour-long talk on every step of the way, but this is just the basics. So my advice is go to your book, read over the chapter on digestion, see if you can fit all these pieces together, and I wish you luck, and I'll see you next time.